Have you advanced enough to make autonomous decisions in code and design? What do you think? I will give you 5 tests so you can measure your level right now. Failing on any of these criteria is not tragic, but it might show you the way to learn and advance. Let's get started with the first test. You will quickly see where this is going. There is the book model. A book might contain a title and a publishing date. Now comes the point where many junior programmers make a mistake. The new requirement is to support books that have not been published yet. Some programmers would add a Boolean flag telling how to treat the publication date. This idea is childish. Some senior programmers do this too, but that is childish. Part of them never grew up. That brings us to the problem I see in less experienced programmers. I will refer to that problem as misuse of derived classes. Inexperienced programmers reach out for a derived class all too easily. This new class indicates that the publishing date should be considered a possibility, not a fact. The difference affects method implementations. For example, the base class might treat the publishing date as something that has already happened. The derived class would override any such implementation and treat the date differently, according to the meaning of this class. If you see no trouble with these two classes, you definitely lack an essential part of knowledge. But don't despair, this design is easy to correct. The first step is to understand that the derived class here is confusing. It is modifying the existing class, where, in fact, there exist two mutually exclusive kinds of books, those published and those that are not. I need to pull the date along with this change. The publishing date only exists in published books. The yet unpublished books will, at most, have a planned publishing date. The common base can only be an abstract class in this design. While you can speak of a book, you can never pass one around. It would either be published or planned. That is the difference between abstract and concrete types. Nevertheless, if you understand why this new design is better than the first one, you are already on the verge of gaining a critical understanding of class derivation. The first design was a clear misuse of derivation. This design, however, is an abuse of derivation. As you continue learning, you will start favoring object composition over class inheritance. Instead of modeling books around their publication status, you model the publication as a separate concept. It could be published on a certain date with a planned publication date or not published yet, but with no additional information. A few other possibilities might pop up later. At some point in your career, you will start favoring this design over those based on inheritance. We don't need derived classes for different kinds of books. There will only be one non-abstract class modeling all kinds of books. Each book will have an abstract publication information. The operations that used to be polymorphic would now be delegated to polymorphic operations in contained components. This implementation avoids class derivation in favor of object composition. If you can correctly name a few benefits of this design, you're definitely not a junior programmer. The next problem I constantly see in junior programmers is visible in the method I plan to implement. The request is to count published books in the set, which might include books that have not been published yet. Many programmers see this as an opportunity to define a static method. A junior programmer might meticulously inspect each object in the sequence and count the preferred ones. A more experienced programmer would see that this entire method is a count link query, with this condition being the predicate identifying objects to count. There is no excuse to avoid a link when writing general-purpose code, especially if no specific limitations are observed. This entire method is just a simple link expression. Imagine another request coming to test whether two books have the same publication status. The method would literally test whether both are published or both not published. To cut a long story short, I would consider both these methods as an abuse of static methods. That is another trait of inexperienced programmers. They believe that these static methods add capabilities to the book class, like counting published books or comparing two books. This power is only an illusion. You don't need a static method that does what a link already does. The reasoning is straightforward. One static method only does one thing, whereas a link can do many other things. Besides counting, I can also isolate the published books, or those that still have no schedule, or any others by the same token. It could make sense to implement some of these operations as strongly typed extension methods, but that is another story. It definitely makes little sense to expose any of those as a static method on the target class. Speaking of the second method, it leaves an impression of an operation that treats two arguments as equally important. Look, I can assign it to a func delegate with two book arguments, which returns a Boolean value. Of course, I can use this func delegate in the subsequent operation. What inexperienced programmers fail to see is that the instance level method loses none of these capabilities. You can assign a lambda to a func delegate if the delegate is required, or use the method directly like any other. Either way, there is no reason to burden the class with static services. If you can see why this design without static methods is better, then you can tap yourself on the shoulder. You have made another giant leap towards becoming an experienced developer. The next issue I constantly see in inexperienced programmers is subtle but with costly consequences. Before that, let me remind you that you can download the source code from this video and all other videos on my channel from my Patreon page. But it is not only about the source code. Each registered patron is helping hundreds of other fellow programmers watch videos for free on my channel. Become a patron and help me keep this content free for everyone else. So the issue I see is about services we use to process objects. This new class is responsible for scheduling a not yet published book for publishing on a specific date. If the book is already published, then we have nothing to do. Otherwise, maybe the suggested date is a weekend or a public holiday. The publisher has no information about that. We use dependencies to resolve this. This interface guarantees to turn an input date into a proper workday. You will frequently encounter similar interfaces in business applications. An example service would be the one that only skips weekends. Then how do we access the calendar where we need it? Even beginner programmers quickly learn that depending on a concrete implementation of an interface is rarely a good idea. So we reach out for injection. That is the topic I want to discuss with you. It takes experience to figure out how and when to inject objects. It all depends on the code that will use this publishing class. One kind of caller would schedule many books to a specific date using one publishing service. Do you see how this code is special? Let me implement it and you will see. Here is the secret. This code doesn't know the calendar. The calendar would be injected into the publishing service and would be inaccessible to the users of this service. Whoever planned to schedule the books using the method below would need to obtain the publishing service first, possibly through injection. Calling the function is now easy. It will work magically. The dependency is hidden inside the service. There are at least two other possibilities when working with dependencies. One is when there is still one publishing service, but each book is published according to a different business calendar. We can address this case using method injection instead of class injection. This design supports the caller who knows the books and the publishing service and additionally knows how to find a business calendar for each book. You can implement this method at your leisure. Let me also show you the combination of the two approaches. There may be one publishing service per country. You might be able to locate the correct service for each book. This is the dreaded service locator pattern, but it's not as bad as some call it. When a man needs it, a man needs it. The code that uses this form of injection would have the books, the desired date, and the service locator that gives it the publishing service suitable for each book. Each of the publishing services would be equipped with the corresponding business calendar. The consuming code would never know how dates are resolved. Isn't that beautiful? Now the revelation. Inexperienced programmers are confused by all these possibilities and usage scenarios for dependency injection. It's because they are missing the point of dependencies. Dependencies serve the caller, and so experienced programmers would start from the calling end. They will understand what the caller needs, but also what the caller has and what it could obtain. Given all these pieces of the puzzle, an experienced programmer would design dependency injection in the most suitable way. Figure this out and you will make another giant leap towards becoming a better programmer. That brings us to the last two points where I see junior programmers fail. This record class will have a property getter with a backing field of type date only. It is a value type, a struct. Many programmers say a value type is allocated on the stack, a reference type is allocated on the heap. Not true. Only junior programmers don't know that. A value type will be allocated where it belongs. If it is a variable inside an executing function, it will naturally end up on the stack. If it is a variable inside another type, it will belong to that type when allocated. This record is the reference type. Consequently, the date-only struct will invariably end up on the heap as part of the allocated object. That is the whole truth. And that brings us to a related point, which we also observe on value types by default. Do you see anything strange in this line of code? Date time is another struct. Its property today returns an instance, a value. How do we add 7 days to this value? Do we change that instance? Do we mutate it as I did with the book class? Obviously not. Mutating a struct requires you to bend the rules of C# quite substantially. If you assign a value to another variable, then the shallow copy would be made in place where that second variable is. Apparently, the only way a date-time instance could add 7 days to itself is to produce another instance that reflects the change. That is called non-destructive mutation. C# structs are notoriously immutable. Then why are my methods not immutable too? Look at my implementation here. I am potentially mutating every single book. Inexperienced programmers often don't see this sharp distinction in how we treat value types as opposed to reference types. The distinction is purely the result of the language implementation, but now it affects my design. Why is that? Those are two distinct planes. This is what I want to see. This implementation is mutable. That is the approach to design many programmers take by default. And I want to see this instead. This is an immutable design. The publishing class does not support it now, hence the compile time error. But you see my intention. I want all objects to retain their shape and content once created. The modifying operations should produce new objects. Do you have an issue with what I said? If you do, you have a problem to solve that has nothing to do with me. If you can accept an immutable design as a viable option but also see where it applies effectively, then you have made another great leap to becoming a great programmer. Now sharpen your tools and watch other videos on my channel that will eventually make you a great programmer.